Praise the Lord. We give you greetings in the precious name of Jesus. We're coming from Greater Works Apostolic New Life Center, right here in the heart of Inglewood, the City of Champions. We thank and praise God for you being here this afternoon, this beautiful afternoon with us. We ask you to praise, worship, be in service with us wherever you are, and where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty. Amen. Hallelujah. Come on, somebody, just where you are, just give God praise. Just lift up your hands and let praises rise. Hallelujah. 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 Come on, somebody, just let praises rise. Lift up your hands. Give God praise. Lift up the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. Somebody said, let praises rise.
Thank you.
Just say to yourself, I have no reason to fear. Come on, somebody, put those hands together. Come on, somebody, lift up the name of the Lord. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Who has the final say?
Who has the final?
Come on, somebody, say, who has the final say?
Who has the final say?
Somebody say, no matter.
Hallelujah. Come on, let's give God some glory. Amen. We're blessed.
Yes.
We're blessed in the cities. We're blessed in the fields.
Yes, yes.
Glory to God. We give honor to God and to all of you once again. We are inviting you to be a part of our giving. Amen. And we're giving with the Cash App, the Givelify, and PayPal. And so we want you to help us to further this gospel of Jesus Christ, this gospel of reconciliation. Amen. And we look to you today for your charitable contributions. Now let us give liberally. Amen. God loves a cheerful giver. And so we're looking for you to help us to continue in this good fight of faith. Once again, our giving is, method of giving is e-giving, PayPal, Givelify, and also Cash App. If you would like to send us a correspondence, we are at Greater Works Apostolic New Life Center, P.O. Box 1066, in Inglewood, California, 90301. You can send your correspondence as well to our P.O. Box. Once again, it's Greater Works Apostolic New Life Center, and we are at P.O. Box 1066, Inglewood, California, 90301. Thank you so much, Greater Works, for your support. Thank you, viewing audience, for your support. We couldn't do this without you. And we walk by faith and not by sight. At this time, let us bring forth the speaker of the hour. None other than our very own Elder Forrest Allen Pikes II. Let's receive him with a hearty amen. Elder Pikes.
Amen, amen.
Amen. Let's give God another hand praise. How many know that you're blessed in the city and you're blessed in the fields and you're blessed when you come and when you go? I thank God for being blessed, amen, through, amen, the name of Jesus. You're only blessed because of the name of Jesus. And I thank God, amen, for our Lord and our Savior, Jesus Christ. Amen. Giving honor to God who is the head of our lives. Giving honor to God, amen, who allowed me to wake up this morning. Someone did not wake up this morning. Someone did not wake up yesterday. Amen. But I thank God for being in the land of the living. Giving honor to my pastor, my father, amen, Pastor District Elder Forrest A. Fikes, the first, and Evangelist Lady Valerie Fikes, amen, my parents, I love them dearly, and I thank God for them, their leadership, their friendship. Giving honor to God for my lovely wife, Minister Melissa Fikes, amen, my eldest sister, Sister Makisha, amen. The entire Fikes family. Amen. Giving honor to my other sister, Sister Kylie, Morgan, Brother Corey, all of my brothers and sisters on both sides. Amen. The Quinn family. Amen. Just thanking God for who He is in our lives. Thanking God for our presiding bishop, Bishop Lambert Gates, amen, Senior, and our diocesan bishop, amen, Bishop Troy Dockery, the first, and also Bishop, our council bishop, amen, Bishop Louis D. Starworth Jr., and all of our bishops and our council and our organizations, amen. Just thanking God for leadership in Jesus' name. We want to go swiftly into the Word of God. I just thank God for His goodness. It's something about the name of Jesus. Amen. It's something about the name of Jesus. The song says, it's the sweetest name that I know. And oh, how I love the name of Jesus. Amen. I wish I could sing that song like I feel it. Amen. Like Rance Allen, but I can't sing like Rance Allen, or I can't sing like, period. So I'm going to just keep that to myself. Amen. I'm going to just keep it in the shower ministry, because I know that when I'm in that shower ministry, I could just flow. Y'all know how when you're in the privacy of your home, you sound good to yourself. But when you step out of the confines of your home, reality quickly sits in. Amen. So I'm going to stay in my lane. I'm going to allow God to bless me. Amen. In this area. So I thank God for His strength, His power. Let us go to the book of 1 Samuel. Amen. Out of chapter number 17. The book of 1 Samuel, chapter number 17. We're going to just read a few passages of scriptures out of the book of 1 Samuel, chapter 17. We're going to start from verses 1. And we're going to go to about, amen, verses 9. I'm going to stop right there. A familiar chapter. The book of 1 Samuel, chapter number 17, starting at verses 1 through 9, in Jesus' name. And it reads,
now the Philistines gathered together their armies to battle, and were gathered together at Shaphath, which belonged to Judah, and pitched between Shechol and Azekiah in Ephraim. And Saul and the men of Israel were gathered together and pitched by the valley of Elah and set the battle in array against the Philistines. And the Philistines stood on a mountain on the one side, and Israel stood on a mountain on the other side, and there was a valley between them. And there went out a champion out of the camp of the Philistines, named Goliath of Gath, whose height was 6 cubits and a span. And he had a helmet of brass upon his head, and he was armed with a coat of mail. And the weight of the coat was 5,000 shekels of brass. And he had greaves of brass upon his legs, and a target of brass between his shoulders. And the staff of his spear was like a weaver's beam. And the spear's head weighed 600 shekels of iron, and one bearing a shield went before him. And he stood and cried unto the armies of Israel and said unto them, what are ye come out to set your battle in array? Am not I a Philistine, and ye servants of Saul to Saul? Choose you a man for you, and let him come down to me. If he be able to fight with me, and to kill me, then will we be your servants. But if I prevail against him and kill him, then shall ye be our servants and serve us.
Father God, in the name of Jesus, so we thank you, Lord, for the word of God on today. We thank you, Lord, for the word going out, and once again, not returning it back to you void. But we thank you, Lord, for it accomplishing everything it was sent to do. We thank you, Lord, for healing in your word. We thank you, Lord, for deliverance in your word. We thank you, Lord, for the apostles' doctrine, which is your word. We thank you, Lord, for salvation, We thank you, Lord, right now for repentance of mind, spirit, and heart. Amen. Bless us in all areas of our lives. Bless us not to forget who you are. We thank you, Lord, right now for standing on your word and standing on your promises, for they are true. In the mighty, matchless name, glorious name of Jesus. In Jesus' name, we all pray. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you, Minister Melissa. Amen. May God add a blessing to the reading and the hearing and the doing of his word. You may be seated. Amen. We thank God for that word. Amen. The scriptures that came out of the book of 1 Samuel, chapter number 17, we read. Amen. Verses 1 through 9. And for a short span of time, we want to speak to your hearing on today. My Goliath must die. My Goliath must die. Amen. It's very imperative and important that when we deal with things that we face in life, good, bad, or indifferent, we have to make sure that we take ownership in facing those things. Amen. And so what we're talking about today is my Goliath must die. What are you saying? Oh, Christ, I'm saying that there are some things that are challenging in our lives in 2020. There were some things that were challenging in our lives in 2019, 18, 17. All this entire millennium, we dealt with challenges, amen. And even though it was a different year, it was the same opposition.
Yes.
And the same opposition was caused by Satan and his imps. Amen. Different face, but same spirit.
Yep.
Amen. Same opposer.
Yes.
Amen. The end-all be-all of the problem, different face, different location, different family member, different situation. Amen. It was still orchestrated by Satan.
Yes.
My Goliath must die. Goliath is anything that is considered to be great in opposition in my life, in your life. I can't always compare my challenges that I face with someone else's. I have to take the ownership that that challenge belongs to me. But in that challenging moment, God will give you the strength, the fortitude, amen, the power through the Holy Ghost that's indwelling inside of you and I to overcome and to kill my and your Goliath.
Yes, yes.
Amen. Let's do a little bit of a background on this brother. Amen. From another mother named Goliath. Amen. Goliath was definitely an opposing force to be reckoned with. In the research that I did with Goliath, he was a Philistine. And not just any old Philistine, but he was considered a champion among men. He was not a loser. He was a champion among champions, among men. Amen. Goliath was a big fella. He was not small in his stature. Amen. The Bible talks about that he was 6 cubits in a span.
That's right.
If you break that down in today's time, he was about 9 feet and about 9 inches tall. Basically, let's just round it, amen, up to the next number. He was about 10 feet. Amen. He was a big dude. Can't you imagine for those who like to swim? Amen. I love swimming, but I love swimming in the shallow end. Amen. Of the pool. Amen. If he goes a little bit over 6 feet, amen, you see a lot of splashing in that area because I'm more comfortable within that area that I am good at. Amen. I need to get better, but I'm good right there. But can't you imagine in a 12-foot pool seeing a gigantuan person walking in 10 feet of water where you can see the top of his head? Amen. I can only imagine someone actually living, a mortal person, 10 feet in height. The Bible describes, amen, how two men had to carry his spear, his sword. Amen. That means that he was so big and so great in size, amen, that two men had to carry his weaponry. Amen. That means it had weight to it. Amen. So can't you just imagine the type of personality that this mortal individual had? I'm pretty sure that he was kind of feeling himself a little bit because he knew about his greatness among men. Amen. So not only being great in size, but actually being a top champion killer. Amen. Being able to take on armies of men in one-to-one combat. Amen. And so now we're facing a dilemma because he feels as though that he is capable and well capable and able to come up against the chosen covenant people of God. Sometimes when you are about you, me, myself, and I, you forget about the Creator that created you. Amen. So Goliath got very, very arrogant in his thinking and cocky in his mindset to think that I can come over here on this side of the coin and take over, amen, the chosen covenant people of God. Amen. In his braggadocious thinking, he began to basically wager against the children of Israel, and he began to tell them, look, nobody to this point has defeated me. Amen. If you got just one person, I mean, the people that you gave, I ate them up. Amen. They were a non-factor. I didn't even really break a sweat with these individuals. And so let me make you a wager right now, talking to, amen, the King of Israel. Not the King of Kings, but the King of Israel at that time. Amen. King Saul. And he began to tell Saul in his arrogance, he said, look, let me just give you a wager of some sorts. If you man that can defeat me, that can fight with me, against me. Amen. If he defeats me, then y'all good. I'm going to go your merry way. Amen. But if I, Goliath, defeats him, amen, then you will become my servants. Then you will have to serve not God, but you will have to serve Goliath. Amen. Sometimes in life, your opposition or your challenges that we all face will try to tell you in such an intimidating fashion and form that look that nothing that you've done so far, thus far, has been able to help you or get you out of your calamity. So this is what's going to happen. If you fail in front of me, then I will be your ruler. Basically, I will be your God. And you will be stuck under my jurisdiction. But what we have to remind ourselves in 2020, amen, and beyond, is that it's not about me, no way. It is about the God that you and I serve. Jehovah is his name. Amen. And we have to always remind ourselves that he is the keeper of our soul. Amen. And so when it gets tough, when it gets rough, when it gets challenging, and sometimes when it just plainly gets intimidating, amen, we have the name of Jesus to call upon in any challenging moment. Let the church say hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
I'm going to take my time a little bit. Amen. Just so I can break it down a little more. Amen. So all this was going on during this time of King Saul's reign. Amen. And all the people of Israel got the word that they were being challenged. Amen. And they were being opposed by the Philistine army. Amen. And so Brother David, amen, the son of Jesse, amen, he got wind of what was going on in the camp. He had a few brothers, amen, that were older than him, that were very talented, very strong, good brothers that were actually a part of the army, amen, at that time of Israel. And he began to hear some of the different information that was being given to each other that, hey, we're up against a challenge. And this challenge is a challenge that we never faced before. This Philistine army is not just a bunch of folks that are opposing Israel, but they are savages, heathens, amen, uncircumcised individuals, amen, that are ready and willing to annihilate the people of God. Amen. And so they are pirates. They are just so messed up that I don't know what we should do. And our king, our fearless leader, Brother Saul, King Saul, does not know how to handle this challenge. That's why it is so imperative and important that we, the covenant people of God, know who to go for answers.
That's right.
Y'all ain't hear me, huh? Sometimes we go to people, huh? And we go to groups of people to answer, amen, challenges that we face, and they don't have the right answer. Instead of going and getting on our knees and praying to a God who has never failed us, who has never lost a case, who has never lost a challenge of opposition, we don't go to him and ask him, Lord, what shall I do? Lord, deliver me. Lord, rescue me. We don't do that. We just succumb to that enemy, that Goliath, in our lives. But today's topic is my Goliath must die. It is okay to kill the enemy for the name of Jesus. Understand what I'm saying. I'm not telling you other fights. The second from the city of champions, Inglewood, California, to go out and physically commit murder. I didn't say that. Get out your mind. We're talking about the Goliath in our lives that are spiritual connections. situations, the Goliath in our lives, that are spiritual stumbling blocks, the Goliath in our lives, that are blocking us from our blessings from above. Some of us don't just have a Goliath. Some of us have Goliaths. Amen. Plural. We got a land of giants that are opposing us in our first family. Our families, amen, outside the church, and our family inside the church. And God is speaking to the hearing of his people today. And he's saying that my Goliath, even if it's singular or plural, they all must die. Yeah. Let God, amen, be in the forefront of our situations. Let's give him some praise. Because today is the last day that we're going to allow a Goliath to be in our situation. Amen. So moving forward, David began to hear the utterings, amen, of the fellow soldiers of his brothers, amen. And they began to speak with, amen, and a lack of wisdom. Now, they began to speak with a lack of faith and confidence that they can defeat this opposing force, this enemy, Goliath. And so they all started to basically pass the buck to each other. David was in and out of those camps because he was a servant by nature. He was a shepherd. He took over, amen, the responsibilities of all of the sheep that Jesse, his father, owned. And David was that dude, amen, that was not about his image at that time. He was very humble in being a servant of not only his father on earth, Jesse, but his father in heaven, Jehovah. Amen. He loved God, and he was passionate about lifting up the name of Jesus. Amen. He was passionate about serving God with gladness and exuberance. Amen. And so as he showed forth his servitude to his father, Jesse, he made sure that all the sheep were attended to. He made sure that no sheep was left behind. He made sure that they were well kept from their captors and their enemies and their predators. Amen. If a lion, which he did, tried to eat up the sheep, he asked God for the spirit and courage, amen, to defeat the lion. Amen. When the bear came and tried to take one of the sheep away from David, amen, he asked God to give him the spirit and the fortitude and the courage to defeat that bear. What am I saying is that notice the pattern. Because David at an early age kept God in his forefront, God strengthened David at every situation, every challenge that he had. He allowed David to be empowered with his power. And David was a conqueror, amen, even at a young age. Amen. He saw something in David that he didn't see in the other brethren. First of all, he saw that David had a heart for God. He saw that David was not ashamed to give God glory. He saw that David was not ashamed to worship him in spirit and truth. He always gave God his props, amen, and his glory and his respect. So once again, when David began to tend to the brothers that were at war with the Philistine army, amen, he was just listening as a young lad, and he heard the utterance, amen, from the other soldiers, and including his brothers, that we are in a bad situation, and none of us are prepared to go out and to fight against Goliath. Let me say something really quick. First of all, we weren't even in, or let's say they, amen, the Israelites, amen, they weren't even in the fullness of the war yet against the rest of the army because they had to deal with Goliath first. As you can see that when you have a Goliath in your life, you can't even get to the whole entire scenario because there is a blockage. There is a stumbling block. There is a challenge directly in front of you. Just do a little bit of a self-evaluation really quick and ask yourself what Goliath has been in your life previously or currently. They just keep popping up their big old head and get in the way of my breakthrough. They're getting in the way of my blessings. I remember Pastor Fikes told me a long time ago, growing up, he said, stop getting frustrated with what is in front of you. Deal with it and kill it so you can move on to the next phase of your life. You've been battling too long on this one thing and it's causing you grief. So get rid of it with the power of your Holy Ghost so you can be an overcomer and keep on keeping on. Some of us have been stuck with Goliath in our lives for too long. Goliath has crept in to our homes, into our houses. Amen. Goliath has, amen, his own room in your house. Amen. And you can't get him out. He's becoming your stronghold. Goliath has taken over your health, your mental health, your physical health. He's becoming a stronghold in your life. Goliath has taken over your church home. He sits on the first three rows of your church house. Amen. He's taken over, amen, the morals and the standards of holiness inside your ministry. He has blocked the ministry of the Word of God from penetrating into the hearts and the lives of the covenant people of God. Goliath must die. Y'all not hearing me on today? Amen. It's time for us to defeat these giants, these hedonistic giants in our lives, and get on the winning team. We're losing too many battles that we should be winning because we allow Satan to come in and to basically metastasize himself. He's spreading across our land. He's spreading across our ministries. He's infecting the word of God that's going into our ministries. And so right now what we have to do is we have to kill Goliath, overcome the enemy so the people of God can be blessed, so the people of God can move forward. Amen. And so David started to tell some of the other folks up under him, around him, why you all acting like you don't know who you serve. Why are you all acting like that you don't know who is in control of our destiny? Why are you making one man seem as though he is the author and the finisher of your faith? Don't you know that you serve a great and a mighty God? Don't you know that he has brought us out of darkness into his marvelous light? Don't you know that when we had nothing, he helped us? When we were in Egypt, he brought us from under Pharaoh. He took us through not just around the Red Sea, but he took us through the Red Sea, and he brought us out land. That's the God that we serve. And so why is it that we're scared? Why is it that we are intimidated? We're intimidated with what the enemy is trying to tell us that he's going to do. David began to speak with boldness. He said, look, stop being a chicken. I'm paraphrasing. Amen. You're being a chicken. You got all these people that worship God in spirit and in truth. And yet, you are allowing this uncircumcised enemy of the chosen people of God to rock your world. Amen. To make you feel like you don't have nothing to offer. To make you feel like you better pack your bags and get up out of here. Who are you to talk to us, the covenant people of God? I said, little old David had to stir the pot a little bit. And he said, look, man, this is crazy. Man, this is ludicrous. How can you, older folks, that know what God has done for you, you sit up there and let the enemy just take you down and rock your world? I just got finished myself taking over a lion by myself because the Lord Host was with me and he gave me strength to overcome that lion wonder in my life.
Hey!
And I took over the lion. He was a toothless lion when I was done with him. He allowed me to conquer the lion. He allowed me to conquer the bear. Those things that are bigger than you, that are instinctively able to kill you.
Yeah.
He gave me the strength from the Most High to go and to obliterate these animals. These are animals of the wild kingdom. So what do you think in your finite mind that you can do against Goliath? Goliath's name, it means to reveal, to uncover. What does that say in other fights? Rich Goliath was fool's gold. Rich Goliath was an empty vessel. Yes, he was big. Yes, he was great amongst men. But when you uncover Goliath in your life, when you reveal what Goliath really is, you will then know that my God is greater. My God is greater. My God is stronger than any Goliath, any opposition that's bigger than me, that's greater than me. God is on the throne, and his promises, they are true. And the devil, he's a liar. That is in me than he that is of the world. It's time to get radical for the Lord. It's time to be encouraged and to say, I can kill Goliath. And not just I can kill him, but he must die. He can't stay here no more. He must go. He cannot stay. In the name of Jesus,
hey!
I'm kicking Goliath out. I'm going to serve him notice. He's getting an eviction notice. He's going to be my most wanted. I'm going to kill him because he's not going to reign in front of the King of Kings,
hey!
And the Lord of Lords.
All right.
How dare you allow your Goliath to tell you and the covenant people of God what he gonna do and how he gonna do it. Who serves a great and a great mighty foe, a powerful God. He's a great mighty and awesome
yeah.
God. Oh, you have forgotten that greater, the creation or the creator. And David started to get a little bit upset and ticked off by the reaction of these soldiers in this army of Israel. Amen. King Saul had to go and consult with Samuel and say, what shall we do? This giant is going to obliterate us. And the word of God began to minister to her. Amen. The prophet Samuel. And Samuel said, there is one that God has chosen. There is one that God sees fit to defeat this enemy. There is one that shows that love, that shows that dedication to God. And he ain't scared of the enemy. The saints of the Most High, of the apostles' doctrine, need not be weary in your well-doing. For in due season, you're going to reap if you faint not. Even when Goliath pops up on the scene, don't faint in the face of adversity. The Bible says, if you faint in the face of adversity, your faith is small. It's time out for buffoonery. It's time out for being scary Mary. Face up to that lion. Face up to that bear. Face up to that Goliath and say, you know what, with the power that God has given me of the Holy Ghost, I'm going to kill my Goliath. Samuel said, I want you to take me, amen, to where Jesse lives at, and see what Jesse got going on. And then they saw that Jesse had a lot of folks, a lot of sons that were capable of fighting, but they weren't the one, amen, that God said he wanted to defeat the enemy. He called on David. Everybody looked at him and said, what? David, the sheep huddler? David, the shepherd boy? He stinks, he's dirty, he's in the field all day. He's not the one that should represent Israel. Oh, don't forget, whoever represented Israel and defeated Goliath, we're going to get all the spoils that came with it. We're going to get Saul's daughter, and they were going to also be the next king. They were also going to have a whole lot of free range in the city. So there were perks and benefits in defeating this enemy. But the Samuel said, look, it's something different about that one. God is trying to tell you right now, he's prepared you for a time like this. He's already getting you ready and gotten you ready to battle against Satan. What we got to do is believe that he is not a liar. If he said he's going to be with you from the beginning to the end, we got to start trusting in God. Why? Because people are waiting on us to help them out. Y'all not hearing me on today. Folks is waiting on us to walk in our apostolic authority so we can rescue the lost and save the souls and take those folks that are backslidden and restore them back to the fold. Take those folks out of the muck and the mire and clay. That's why we got to start doing some more work for the Lord. That's why we have to kill our Goliath. Those stumbling blocks, get rid of them. Lord, I need you like never before. It's time to be more than a conqueror. Not just a conqueror. Not just someone that operates in mediocrity. But being more than a conqueror. I'm not scared of the enemy. Because God has fortified my life. He has equipped me for such a time as this. Let the church shout hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Goliath must die. He must die. Amen. Brother David said, look, let me talk to the king himself. I got a bone to pick with King Saul. King Saul, what are you doing, man? Why are we at the mercy of Goliath and the Philistine army? Why are we basically being told what we should do and what we shouldn't do? King Saul did not have an answer, but what he did see is that Brother David had the biggest heart that outweighed the heart of his proclaimed soldiers. So King Saul said, look, let me give you a little bit of weaponry, because I know you haven't been trained properly. Let me give you something that will help you at least survive, amen, the weaponry of Goliath. And he began to put armor on David. And David looked at the armor and said, look, man, I know you mean well, but this armor is not gonna fit. Why doesn't it fit? Somebody might ask. It's because this is not what God is calling me to do. Amen. This is not going to prepare me for war. See, you got to ask yourself, Lord, what do I need to prepare for this opposing force, this opposing enemy? And sometimes we ask the wrong individual, and they say, well, if you do this and do that, but what did God tell you to do on how to overcome your Goliath? See, your Goliath is custom made for you. Your Goliath in your life, your giant in your life, is custom made for you and I. So that's why it takes a God to lead us and guide us into all truth and righteousness on how to defeat the enemy. And so then David said, you know what, I'm okay, because I come in the name of the Lord of hosts. I don't need all that. God is speaking to me right now, and he told me to just get five smooth stones. Why five? I don't know. But let me tell you something. God said five smooth stones. And he began to say, I'm going to go out there. I'm going to let Goliath know who I represent. And so when David went out there, the shepherd boy, but not just any old shepherd boy, the person that loved God to the highest level, he said, look, I am David, and I come in the name of the Lord of hosts. Oh, Goliath, ha, ha, ha. He began to laugh at David, and he said, this is what you are bringing to me in terms of a challenge. You're telling me that you're sending a boy to do a man's job. Oh, the devil is something else. He was mocking the covenant people of God. This is all you got. You gave me some scraps and telling me that this scrappy boy, he got heart. I give him that, but he's stupid. He's foolish. And I'm about to kill him really good. Just so I can let y'all know that you all are mine. And he began to take his spear. Amen. And he began to throw that spear at David. Amen. And David was able to get out of the area of that spear. He ducked and was able to get away from being stabbed to death by that spear. See, when you walk into the anointing of God, God will protect you even in the valley of your enemies. Even when folks are ready and salivating to eat up your flesh. The Bible says in Psalms that my enemies are stumbled and fail. Let me tell you something. When God prepares you for battle, you will come out victorious.
Yeah.
And your Goliath will die.
Right.
So what he began to do, he began to stir up those gifts that were within him.
Yeah.
And he began to take those because it's the name of Jesus that demons howl at that name. Every knee, every knee, even the lion's knee, every knee is going to have to bow, and every tongue is going to have to confess that Jesus is Lord of Lords. So David began to take that slingshot, and I believe, this is my belief, I believe that when David was asking God to give him the strength to slay this giant, not because he just didn't want to be killed himself, but he knew that if it don't happen right now, we're all doomed, and the entire covenant people of God will be captured, will be held in captivity and killed. So he said, Lord, anoint my hand. I know he was saying, Lord, anoint these stones to penetrate and to knock down these enemies. You did it before, and you can do it again. You gave me power over the lion. You gave me power over the bear. You made the bear a teddy bear. You made the lion a rug as I was down with it. Now I know that you can put this dude named Goliath to his knees. We need to know that you are still in the blessing business. We need to still know that you are a deliverer, that you are a way maker, and we need you to deliver us. And as those slingshot began to go in a circular motion, amen, and he flung that anointed smooth stone, I really believe in my heart that God, he escalated the speed and the trajectory of that stone. He took it to another lunar level. And this is for my people that are called by my name. This is for the folks that are saying that I believe in God. Even when a giant is in front of them, I believe in God. I know God is going to rescue me. And that trajectory of that stone turned me into a bullet. That might have been the first bullet that was shot. Amen. And that bullet penetrated, amen, the frontal lobe of this giant named Goliath. And the people that were rallying around, amen, this demon, this chief demon, this champion demon, they probably saw him just kind of leaning a little bit, amen, until the legs got kind of wobbly. And then the force and the trajectory, not of the stone, because we're not talking natural, we're talking supernatural. When you're dealing with demon fighting, you're not talking natural no more. We're talking supernatural.
All right.
God had to take control of the wheel. And he said, let me handle this. Because who's talking too much smack? I can't allow him to insult my intelligence like that. And so as he blew his breath, his power on that stone, and that stone entered, amen, the forehead of Goliath, Goliath began to fall down. When you are a child of the Most High, when you are covenant people of God, when you fast and pray, when you rebuke the devourer, and when you say that no weapon is formed against me will prosper, God will fight your battle. The Bible says, if I hold my peace and let the Lord fight my battle, it's time for the lion to die. Not just time for his death. Not just time for his departure. But he must die. You can't say that you serve a great and mighty God and you don't kill the opposing forces that are in front of you. He was telling God, basically, you ain't nothing, Lord. He was assaulting God. How dare he? How dare they? They're trying to tell you at the workplace, you don't have the qualifications to get that raise. You don't have the qualifications to get that promotion. My Goliath must die, because I serve a great God. I serve a God that is a way maker. He will give me the intellect. He will give me the opportunity. Oh, my family is so up. I'm the flow up. My Goliath must die. This is going to be unification in this family. I'm speaking it. We're going to be on the same page. We're going to coexist because of blessings and unity of the family. My church is in a disarray. My Goliath must die. They're contaminating the common people of God. They don't want to be saved. They want to be wayward. Lord, give me the wisdom to subdue this giant and to eradicate him. When David said who he came in the name of, it wasn't David. It wasn't the house of Jesse. It was the name of the Lord of hosts. Amen. And when he said that, he was endued with power to conquer the enemy. And when Goliath fell to his knees, it didn't just stop at that. Because maybe Goliath could have just been unconscious. Maybe Goliath could have just had a really bad headache. But God said, David, finish him. Those who grew up in the 90s, there was a video game called Mortal Kombat. And once you win against your opponent, then the last thing the video game says is finish him. And then you can do whatever you want to do to make sure they don't get back up. We got to make sure that the enemy cannot get back up.
Yes.
We got to settle all times with the devil and make sure he don't get back up.
Yes.
We got to defeat him for good. Sure, that we don't make our stronghold stronger. We gotta uproot the enemy and his devices and his snares and his toils. The Bible says David picked up a sword that normally two men were supposed to pick up. And I believe that God said, finish him, David. And he took that sword. And he took that sword as representation of the Lord of hosts. And he slain the head. He decapitated the head of Goliath. And the enemy was defeated. We must finish the job that God has assigned us to do. This is not to make you feel that you have to be a bully, but Satan is already a bully.
Yes.
God don't want you to be a bully. He wants you to defeat the bully to his glory, for his glory, so the lost can be found, so the unsaved can be saved.
Hallelujah, hallelujah.
Let the church say hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Amen. I'm excited because I know that we deal with giants every day. And instead of just talking about the giants and how great they are and how and what they could and might do, let's start killing these giants. Let's start killing the spirit of these giants. The Bible says he'll make your enemies your footstool. Growing up, I thought it just meant, okay, I put my foot on the enemy's neck, figuratively speaking, but a footstool really is to help you elevate. It's to help you go up, go further. Amen. We have to take on that passionate spirit of the young David. Amen. That was like, look, you're not going to desecrate the name of the Lord. not under my watch. God has been so good to David. David said, I can't just allow you to lay down and die. I teach my sons and my little brother all the time. I said, look, never just lay down and die. Ask God for that power. Amen. You got the Holy Ghost. Ask him to give you that power, to ignite that power over your fears, over those things that you were scared or afraid of, because he didn't give you the spirit of fear, but of power, love, and of a sound mind. No matter what sequence of order that you put those characteristics in, they are what they are. Power, love, and of a sound mind. And because of that, he exposed to the whole region that Goliath is nothing but a scarecrow. That Goliath can be defeated. And not because his name was David from the house of Jesse, but it was because he walked in his authority under the name of the Lord of hosts. And because he had God in front of him navigating his steps, that's why he defeated that giant. When are you going to defeat that giant or those giants in your life? Some of us, we've been dealing with this squad of giants. Some of us for a number of years. And you know what? The giants don't get old. They just keep messing with you. They don't get old. They don't have back pains and they don't, you know, need surgery. They don't retire. They stay there as long as you keep them there. God is saying, today, my Goliath, your Goliath must die. Yeah. We can't have any more opposing forces that are stopping the praises and the worship to God or the blessings to God from God any longer. Amen. This pandemic has taught me personally a great deal to operate in my faith. Amen. Because as we can see right now, the church houses are half empty. Some of our church houses are totally empty. But just because there's no one in the pews, or a whole lot of people in the pews, doesn't mean, amen, the word of God should stop going forth. We have to tell people about the goodness of Jesus. We have to tell people that you can be saved, that you can be freed from sin, that you can be delivered. It's not a hoax. You can't overcome sin. You can't overcome homosexuality, drug addiction, lying, fornication, murder, all those things. You can overcome with the power of the Holy Ghost and the baptism in the name of Jesus. These are all Goliaths. These are all giants that have blocked us from our blessing. And the only way you're going to move forward is if you defeat the giant from top to bottom. You got to knock him out, and then you got to kill him. My Goliath must die in Jesus' name.
Hallelujah.
Testament. And when he is dead, you must finish him off.
That's right.
Amen.
You can't just cut the arms off of your opposition. You can't just cut his legs off. The giants in your life, you got to finish him off. This giant that we're talking about is lives that are oppressed, lives that are hopeless, lives that have given up. But I'm here today to say to you, the viewing audience, where there is life, there is hope. And the happy ending to this story, to this narrative, is that he cut off the head of this giant. We are going to have to cut off the head, not his arm, not his leg, but his head. We're going to have to finish him off. We're going to have to teach our children to finish him off. Don't just cut off his arm, his leg. Giant in your life is to be born again of the water and the spirit. To give all of your heart, your mind, your soul, and your strength to David's God, Jehovah. We gotta finish him off. We can't let him survive. We can't leave this giant on the ground with a heartbeat. We have to finish him off. The only way out is the way in.
All right.
Today, your day for salvation. We got to finish him off now. We're talking about the giants in your life.
Yes.
Pastor Fights, how do you finish him off? I've struggled with this giant for many, many years.
My God. Jesus.
First of all, you can't let him bind the strong man. If he binds the strong man, he's got your house. Days should speak, the multitude of years should teach us something.
Yes.
It's time to finish him off. It's time to become victorious. I'm speaking to the few of you that have somehow thought in your mind that you can defeat this giant in your life without God. But let me say this to you. This God created that giant, and it took a God to defeat that giant. The giant in your life today can be defeated only through Jesus, our champion, the one that gave his life that we might have life and that more abundant. The one that said, he that suffers with me shall reign with me. It's time to become victorious. You can't preach this gospel without water. Come, let us baptize you in Jesus' name, for the remission of your sins.
Yes.
and ye shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. Now, I have cut off the head of my giants. Goliath must die first, that I might live with Jesus. Come, let us baptize you in Jesus' name for the remission of your sins, and ye shall receive the gift of the Holy Ghost. We would like to extend that invitation to our covenant fellowship, to you to become a part of this growing ministry. Please fill that form out. It's at www.gwanlc.org. Now, this is your first step to becoming victorious. Again, that website, the platform that we have with that application is gwanlc.org. We'll do the rest. But you must, hear me now, you must be born again of the water and the Spirit, the Holy Ghost shall lead you and guide you into all truth and righteousness. Goliath, I'm speaking to you. You must die. And we, the covenant people of God, will finish you off. May God richly bless you and keep you. This is our prayer.
Yes.
And remember this. Whatever you do and wherever you go, take Jesus with you. God bless you in Jesus' name.